1 Samuel chapter 17, and frankly, it's a little long. It's also something you've probably heard before. And so here's what I'm going to ask. For those who have committed to helping me, I'm going to invite you to the front right now, if that's all right. There's a way of reading Scripture, because I think a lot of times we picture a particular thing when we hear Scripture, especially if we've heard it many times over and over again. So I think what I'm going to ask is this. There is a bell here. It sounds a lot like this. And by a lot, I mean it sounds exactly like that. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads when you hear this sound. And imagine as I read, just keep your eyes closed and I will read through a section. And then, when I hit a certain point, I will ring it again. And I invite you, when you hear that, to look up and maybe be inspired by anything you see. I don't know where, but just, you know, maybe. And then I'll ring the bell again, and I invite you to put your hand back down. So we can all practice right now, because I realize it was very complicated. So we're good. That second one was my fault. It was quiet, but each time we looked down, that was great practice. Okay. Hear now a word from the Lord. Now the Philistines gathered their armies for battle. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs, and a javelin of bronze swung beneath his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. And his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted at the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? Are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me. If he is able to fight and kill me, then we will be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then you shall be our servants and serve us." And the Philistine said, "Today I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man that we might fight together." When Saul and all of Israel heard these words of the Philistine, they were dismayed and greatly afraid. Now Saul and they, all the men of Israel, were in the valley of Elah, fighting with the Philistines. David rose early in the morning, left the sheep with a keeper, took the provisions, and went as Jesse had commanded him. He came to the encampment as the army was going forth to the battle line, shouting the war cry. Israel and the Philistines drew up for battle, army against army. David left the things in charge of the keeper of the baggage, ran to the ranks, and greeted his brothers. As he talked with them, the champion, the Philistine of Gath, Goliath by name, came up out of the ranks of the Philistines and spoke the same words as before, and David heard him. David said to Saul, "Let no one's heart fail because of him. Your servant will go and fight this Philistine." Saul said to David, "You are not able to go up against the Philistine to fight him, for you are just a boy, and he has been a warrior from his youth." But David said to Saul, "Your servant used to keep sheep for his father. And whenever a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth. And if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw and strike it down and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them. since he has defied the armies of the living God. David said, "The Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of the Philistine." So Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried to walk in vain, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. Then he took a staff from his hand and chose five smooth stones from the wadi. And he put them in his shepherd's bag, in the pouch, and his sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The Philistine came on and drew near to David, with his shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked at David and he saw him, he disdained him, for he was only a youth, ruddy and handsome in appearance. The Philistine said to David, "Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?" And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine said to David, "Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the air and the wild animals of the field." But David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword and spear and javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, and the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This very day the Lord will deliver you into my hand, and I will strike you down and cut off your head, and I will give the bodies of the Philistine army to this very day to the birds of the air and the wild animals of the earth, so that the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not say by sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand." When the Philistine drew near to meet David, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground.
And he tells them one time, one time, I raced the fastest kid on a bike in town. 99 times out of 100, he beat me. But one time, I beat Billy Simpkins down Sherry Road. And the kid said, "You beat Billy Simpkins?" He said, "Yeah, one time." And another kid said, "You know what? One time I was at a birthday party, and I did a backflip off the high dive, and my brother chickened out." Another kid was like, "Your brother chickened out?" He was like, "Yeah, one time." And then the next kid, one time, by the end of it, all had that one time, and then they went out, and guess what? They won. One time, they won. I cry every time. Oh, it's so great. Out of nowhere is the message, this Hollywood wonderful message. Out of nowhere, for some flukish reason, you can overcome. You can overcome all the odds and beat the big guy. Out of nowhere. That's the message of Little Giants. Out of nowhere, you can win. And it works. It works, frankly, because after that game, when the game is over, you get up and throw away your empty box of Junior Mints and that 165-ounce Coke that you paid $30 for, and you go home. And that story is over, and you go do a different thing. The problem is, in real life, it doesn't end right after the game, and it doesn't start right before the game. There's a whole lifetime to live. I mean, can you imagine how sad that would be if, like, it was more of a documentary that told the story of these kids, and it was like, you know, one time, and you know, these kids are 95, and like, actually, I've been a huge failure my entire life, but one time when I was 9, I won this football game, and they were really big kids, and that was just for effect. It doesn't work. It only works if you tell the story, and you boil an entire life down to one event. The problem is this: David lived an entire lifetime. But we treat this movie like the stories, like the movies. We love the idea of this little shepherd boy taking care of his sweet little sheep, and he just kind of stumbles into this, you know, war zone, and oh my goodness, he's a war hero! And that's what we think, like, that's the movie. That's the one time, and that's what we like to say. But here's the problem. It doesn't go like that. Life doesn't work like that. We can't just sit around hoping one day that out of nowhere we'll just be sitting there like David, and suddenly we will save the world. It's a sweet note, sweet idea, but quite frankly, you've wasted a lot of boxes of Junior Mints thinking that that's how life is going to work out. The fact is this: on Father's Day in particular, I know of a lot of heroic language that gets sort of attached to fatherhood, gets attached to, and for any of us really, gets attached to something, you know, being great. Heroes. We want to be a hero. The problem is just this: heroes don't sit there and then suddenly save the world. It's not how it works in this story. It's not how it works in life. Heroes actually were working on things a long time before this whole story. Some of you have read some books by Malcolm Gladwell. His actual most recent book was called David and Goliath. And I have to tell you that some of his sort of musings might be a bit of a stretch, but the fact is, his underlying message is a very good one, and that is, the story of David's victory is not a fluke. And this moment did not just suddenly happen. He points out a number of things. One is David's weapon of choice, a sling. Now, if you're like me, you always picture the slingshot. Like, you know, a Dennis the Menace kind of slingshot, right? And it's really good for just making somebody mad. That's about what it's good for. There were actually people called slingers. I don't know what the Hebrew is, but we'll just stick with slingers, okay? And in fact, oftentimes, shepherds were the best slingers. Now, these slingers would take a stone, and this is baseball-sized but denser than baseball stone, and they would put it in a long leather strap, and they would swing it around their heads, and they would launch it at speeds well over 100 miles an hour. And there are stories, there are historical findings of stories of slingers knocking birds out of the air. This is deadly accuracy. This is what a slinger could do. Meanwhile, Goliath was wearing armor that was over 125 pounds. He was carrying a spear that was over 20 pounds. The tip was over 20 pounds. pounds. You can imagine how quick Goliath was, because Goliath was had trained as soldiers train, which is for hand-to-hand combat. You train with a sword, you train for somebody directly in front of you, you train to fight hand-to-hand. Interestingly, David had not trained as a soldier. David had trained as a shepherd boy. David did not sit with his fellow countrymen and listen to this giant taunt them day after day after day after day, which I can only imagine would sort of wear down one's morale. David came in from the outside because he had been tending sheep. And when he arrived, he brought new eyes. He brought a righteous anger. And he brought this tool that was like something that soldiers didn't really fight with. And he saw what was going on, and he knew that some time ago he had been anointed, and that this nation was something he should be proud of. He knew that nobody should sort of taunt God, and he said, you know what, I'm going to do this. Saul puts on his own armor. David very kindly says, I can't use this armor because it hasn't been tested. Really, probably the underlying message is, I don't need this stuff. Please get it off of me. But he was respectful, and I think that was nice. And then it says this, David goes running out to the battle line to meet with Goliath. The language shows Goliath sort of lumbering forward, and Goliath even says, it looks like a taunt, come closer to me so that I can kill you or something of that sort. But really what it might be is the realization that I need this kid to be close if I'm going to do any damage at all. No, friends, the fact is this, in this situation, with these tools, David was the boy. He didn't wake up that morning with a skill. David had been faithful with a very mundane job year after year after year, and he was excellent at a sling. And so when he saw a giant test his God, frankly, he wasn't so afraid of the sword. It just wasn't that scary. David was the bully. Goliath didn't stand a chance. I think we would do well to quit thinking that heroes wake up with superpowers. Heroes don't wake up with superpowers. Heroes have been practicing being faithful day after day after day. You hear Jesus say in Luke, if you are faithful in the little things, you will be faithful in the large ones. But if you are dishonest in the little things, you won't be honest with greater responsibilities. David is not a holy hero. David didn't wake up and find out that he was going to save the earth. David had been given a lot in life. It was a really impressive job, but he did it well. And then without ever having been able to write this story, one day it came in really, really handy when he saved the world, like a superhero. I think we're really, really good at discounting our lot of life. I think we're really, really good at saying, oh, I'm just a kid, I'm just a student, I'm just a mom, I'm just a dad, I'm just an employee, I just have a job that I hate, and I just. And what this story says to me is be faithful where you are because you are not writing the story that God is writing. God has placed you somewhere, be faithful there, and you have no idea what God's going to do. We are one thing, and that is children of God. And we are called to be heroic. In my mind, heroes are faithful in what is, so that they are prepared for what is to come. Heroes are faithful in what is, so that they are prepared to be faithful in what is to come. Or Proverbs would say it like this, keeping in mind the plans of the way, but the Lord directs the steps. So how are you that sort of discounting where you are now? Pretty easy. Because while you tend sheep, somehow God is weaving together a story that you would never write on your own. And it turns out the very tools that you are honing, the very skills that you are honing, happen to be the skills that are necessary for the story God has written for you. Sheep herding did not make kings. And yet here it does. And so I would say this, we are invited, as best we can, to take an active part in the faithful practice of following Christ from wherever we are. The narrative the Bible gives us happens to, if you've gotten really good at discounting your particular place, just know that the Bible I read picks those people in particular. The ones that are just sure that they are forgotten, those are the ones that get noticed, those are the ones that get used. Just be faithful where you are. You are not forgotten. You are not forgotten. Please don't make it forgotten. So I'd like for you to repeat after me something. I'd like for you to try starting your day in a particular way. It's been a good reminder for me. Today I am training for the exact kind of ministry that God has in store for me. Today I'm training for the exact kind of ministry that God has in store for me. Last time. Today I am training for the exact kind of ministry that God has in store for me. So some of us are called to take care of aging parents, as some of us are called to taking care of another kid in our house, as some of us are called to DC or to stand with a hurting friend who is facing cancer, or to just be with people, even people who don't want you to be with them. Be faithful in what is, so that you're prepared for what is to come. Amen.